So you said you've been here since 1965.
So this would be my 53rd year, because yes, we moved, and I've been in my home for 53 years. We built our home here, and we visited Morrisville Methodist Church, and we visited this church, and right away I knew this was the church.
Then we ended up here. So, and like I said, I think I have been a member forever.
We visited Yardley the first time. People here were so friendly. And the second time I came, people knew me by my name, which really impressed me. It was small, not a large church, which is kind of what we were looking for. But it was the people of the church that just kind of drug me in here, drew me to it. So it was a pretty easy decision after three visits.
Since then, what keeps us here is the people and all the activities and the real feel of love that exists at the church. The reason why we're here originally was for the youth program. We're in a smaller church downtown that did not have as strong of a program. So the strength of the program, and obviously youth pastor Denise was the biggest link or the biggest hook.
The leadership in this church is excellent, outstanding leadership.
Yeah, so, you know, actually, I got to credit, you know, Denise for her mentorship with me. Denise Harris is our awesome youth pastor.
I really liked about the church, in addition to how active the youth program was and how much fun the kids seemed to have, the first time we visited, the youth were sitting up front. And to see them not only here and in the church, but willingly sitting up front and engaged was something that really drew us.
Yeah, sometimes I think I'm having too much fun. The children's moments, I have to say, are probably one of my favorite parts about Sunday morning. And the reason why is because the children are so open to, they listen and they respond. And I can be playful in ways with children that are that helps share a message with them.
When I came out to this, when I heard the music, I had to come back. And Eduardo is absolutely wonderful. He's our choir director, okay? We are so fortunate to have him, and the variety of the music that we have is unbelievable.
My faith goes through the music making, you know? It's not the only way, but that's a very strong way. Being involved in some of the mission programs here, being able to participate in that, you know, it also sort of diversifies what you do, but it all brings it, in the end, it all brings it together. There's a lot of connection between music and faith, and allowing the music to sort of express your faith, you know. There's a saying out there that, you know, music speaks when words can no more. Faith goes in a large percentage through the music making, sometimes as a participant, sometimes as a leader.
One of the things that has been so meaningful for me is the disciple class. And spending 4 years in disciple has really not only helped me learn and really dig into the teachings of the Bible, but the camaraderie that we have created among all of us that are in the disciple group. You spend 4 years with a group and, you know, 12 to 15 people, and we really get to know them and we help each other.
The disciple, we really connected that group. But it was just really good to learn things about the Bible that I did not know.
I have seen some of these people who came to our class and were so afraid of not knowing certain things and that they would be judged. And I just hope that in some way we were able to make them feel welcome and feel understood. And now I just see them in the church blossoming, and I see them kind of carrying that on, you know, to others. That, you know, you can always look up things in the Bible. Like, we want to teach our children the Bible stories, but the most important thing is teaching them how Christ wants us to live. And that, you know, she said, that you can do. Like, you don't have to study the Bible all night to start teaching them how you want Christ to be seen in their eyes and how you want, you know, his reflection to be a part of who you are. And, you know, I just always try to make the people feel that when they come to our class, that you don't have to know everything. We don't know everything. We're just kind of moderating it. And
the church is just has a very active social network of connections. I had 5 kids in 6 years, and so there were lots of meals and all kinds of things that were supportive that the church did for us. One church member, I was on bed rest with my twins, and so basically I could stand up for like 10 minutes a couple times a day, and I had 3 other kids running around, and she came over, vacuumed my floor, and put a baked ziti with sausage in the oven for the family to eat that night. That's a friend.
Everybody was pitching in, making dinners. When somebody else had a baby, everybody jumped in. And when we had babies, which we ended up having a lot. So actually at some point I was like, oh my gosh, enough. You know, it's like the 5th time when we had, you know, twins in Alaska around, so really the 4th time that people had brought us like meals for a week and helped us with our house. And I'm like, you know, we gotta help somebody else because we've got our fair share.
You know, parents who are ahead of me, like when my kids were little, I could talk to parents of teenagers and they would say, hey, look out for this. And you know, this is things like that. And it was like, oh, okay.
Well, there isn't really any one example because it's like my life. Like I really, my whole life has been in the church. Like I've pretty much come every Wednesday and Sunday since I was like 6.
I've now participated. I've been interns at Next Step Ministries, which is a national organization that our high schoolers go on the mission trip. So it's near and dear to our heart, those mission trips.
The range of opportunities here at the church, you can be involved on something on a weekly basis, or you can get involved with some of the bigger projects. Something I really enjoy is the church has left the building, which is a day where on Sunday morning you come in your grubby clothes and you say a quick prayer and you run out into the community and spend the day working.
There was a huge famine that affected the rest of the continent. Having grown up there, I was very much used to an abundance of water. Especially in April when I visited, there would have been water everywhere for animals, for people, and the produce would have been abundant at that time. This particular year, there was absolutely nothing. I came and shared it with some of my colleagues that were in the, in my circle of friends from church. Those are the guys who encouraged me to move forward and make it a community project for the church to hear about. Fortunately, it got such a big attraction, a big attendance. Within about 5 years, we graduated from doing 1 well per year to almost like 10 wells, 15 wells, and eventually, after about maybe 8 years, we were actually doing about 30 wells per year. It was a significant growth, and each one of these wells, by the way, does cover anywhere from 1,000 people to about 1,500. So it is a big number of people who really need, whose life are changed forever from just 1 well.
So,
wait, do you need my name?
Yeah, you do your slate first.
So my name is Denise Harris.
Can you do it to the camera?
No. My name is Denise Harris. I am the youth director at Yardley United Methodist Church, and I've been here for 16 years. The biggest change that's happened here is when I first started here, the youth ministry was very much off in its own corner, and their solution for the fact that they saw so many youth coming into the program was, or so many kids coming up into the youth program in the few years, was to hire a youth minister. And so once I was hired full time, it was kind of like, Denise is gonna take care of all things youth. And we're good. Now we've got it covered. And now it's very, very different. The church actually, it takes ownership of the youth ministry. Like the fact that on Sunday mornings, kids are talking to other adults and not just me, says that this church does youth ministry and didn't just hire someone to keep them in the corner.
The reason why I do Sunday school now and do the youth leader stuff is because that's the most enjoyable thing. I kind of feel more at peace with God and working alongside with God instead of just working. You know, because anything you do can be considered work, but if you enjoy it a lot, it's just a different passion and flavor to it. So if you have that calling, And I would say whether it's Sunday school or just youth leadership in general, you know, where you're helping the youth, it's a life-changing experience. You know, as much as you're teaching them, they're teaching you.
Getting these experiences, like I'm not saying that if a kid is in sixth grade, they have to know God and they have to be, you know, like have perfect attendance in church and all that stuff by the time they graduate high school. But I want them to have had opportunities to grow closer to God.
Place where that kid can feel comfortable. And there's not a lot of places like that. There's a lot of pressure, whether it's, you know, sports or school or all different things that, you know, put pressure on kids. And this is an easy way for a kid to feel comfortable, learn about God, kind of shape their moral character as they move forward, because that's a tough time. You know, a lot of kids pull these kids in middle school and high school.
I'd say that the differences between outside and here was that you could be kind of like more yourself almost, and it really didn't matter. I know for me, there's some, like most of my good friends now, you don't really have to be any different, but I know there was definitely some things that I didn't talk about with or do with my one group, with like all my other groups of friends at school, that I didn't have a problem with here.
Do you have an answer for that, Thomas?
Yeah, literally, at church you can be yourself here. I've never had an environment where people are so willing to accept you. I mean, I don't think I do half the stuff at school just because I don't really care enough to. But here it's like I know people accept me, and that's what we do for everyone. We accept, and then a lot of time we just have fun, and it's just a very welcoming environment.
100%. Yeah. Maybe even more important sometimes, because the parents are the ones that are raising the kids. Like, I have the joy of interacting with these youth on a different level, because we see each other in youth group, we go on trips, like they experience some of their biggest growths in their faith journey in the youth ministry, but it's only for a short amount of time. Parents have the number one influence on their kids, and they always will. And so the need to support the parents and encourage them and remind them that they're doing a good job, because every parent or teenager will tell you they don't know what they're doing, and they don't know who this person is that used to be their child. And so I think youth ministry more so actually focuses on the need of like the parents. It's hard to disconnect, and there's no reason to. When they become adults, that's all the more reason to make sure that they're doing okay and check in on them.
But the mission that's probably most near and dear to my heart is the My Calling mission trip, which was founded by three youth in our church, and truly inspiring that they wanted to come up with hosting a mission trip on their own. The work that they put into it was just awe-inspiring. And
for some reason, the administration of this church and the people of this church have faith in the youth here, and I guess it works out. I mean, like, it seems like it works out.
It does.
But, like, I still don't get it.
I mean, they let us choose where we go on the mission trips. They let us lead the mission trips. They let us do a lot of things.
My Calling, I said, it was a blast. I thought that was fantastic.
The first year we had 12 youth that attended, and then the next year was 24 youth, then 48, and then last year we had, this year, over 100 youth in place, total 175 people involved, serving at 15 sites.
What's the word? The centerpiece right now. For me, they are the centerpiece of social action and outreach ministry.
Just to go and see how enthusiastic the youth are about helping others and worshiping God, that really is something to see.
If they came there to work, and they did it, and I can remember talking to Farmer John at the farm, and he was saying, you know, these kids are real workers. He said, and I'll tell you the truth, he said, I appreciate what they're doing. And when I talked with Trish at the Pendel Food Pantry, and she took me aside and she said, the work that they did has been fantastic.
And the band we had last year, it was just incredible. And the services. So to sit in our church on Sunday mornings, we typically go to the 9 o'clock service, which is the celebration service. equivalent, and to feel the energy, the contrast between that, which would be the more high energy service, and that my calling service with the youth and the energy. It was a real moment, I think, for this church.
It's ridiculous the amount of youth, the amount of leadership that you can gain and you can find at this church. Because there's not like,
I mean, I know so many kids that come into this church, they're scared of talking to people and doing things, and then they finally learn, they like start to do leadership stuff, and then they start getting out of their comfort zone, and then they don't have a problem doing things in the future.
Extremely important. I'm still amazed at the moral and spiritual compass that was instilled in my two girls. You know, I saw it then, and I saw it happen to my children, and, you know, while they were raised in the church. And I see it today, with the kids growing up. Many of them that are in the senior high programs and high school programs, you know, I can remember them when they were infants. You know, just to watch them grow is just wonderful. You know, that's the primary reason that I continue to support the church as best that I can.